My name is Maaret Pyhäjärvi, and as you might have guessed from the comment of you don't sound like Finnish, I'm from Finland. I've been a tester for 23 years, and I've been an agilist for years that I can't even count anymore. And today I'm here to share an experience report in a way, to talk about learning through osmosis, which is a thing that I want to talk about through an experience that I had a couple of years ago. So let's get into that. Since this is very much a personal story that I'm sharing with you today, I would like to remind you that whatever I'm sharing, it is to share one perspective, one experience, and I hope it gives you some ideas, at least it gives you hopefully some inspiration, but I don't expect it to be a how-to guide into how to do all of this stuff. So pick the pieces that you like. Hopefully there's lots of those things, and let's think around those things. So the story that I'm about to tell you is a story about finding mob programming. So there's two parts to this talk. First, I'm going to share you the way that I found mob programming, and then I'm going to tell you what I learned while doing mob programming. So that's the way of learning through osmosis for me. The first part really starts from the story of me. And I've been a tester for quite many years. Nowadays, I work at F-Secure. I've worked there for 9 months now. And for that 9 months, I've had a bit of an identity crisis in the sense that they call me a lead quality engineer. That's the title for a hands-on tester at F-Secure. But also, whenever I introduce myself, I usually need to tell people that I'm not responsible for anything, which means that I can be responsible for whatever I feel like being responsible for. That's what it's like to be in an agile team. Regardless of whatever your title is, you do whatever you need to do in order to do a good product. So a lot of times I find myself to wear the tester hat. A lot of times I find myself to wear a programmer hat. But that was not a hat I was comfortable wearing 3 years ago. And this is really what the story today is about. Before F-Secure, I worked in a company called Granlund. It's a relatively big construction-oriented or construction business company in Finland. And they have this very tiny software development unit of about 20 people. And when I was hired there about 5 years ago, I was the first tester that company ever had. They had been doing software development for about 20 years by that time, but I was the first professional tester they ever hired. I also turned out to be the first woman they ever hired into the software development part of the company. So I was there, you know, in my natural habitat with the other IT people. But I felt very different. A lot of times my colleagues, you know, the developers, the programmers, and the project manager with a technical background, with a programming background, they would be talking about things like how awesome technologies they were seeing. Like this new technology, we could try this out, and they were getting excited about that. And I felt very alone when I was getting excited about, oh see, this bug, look at this. It's something that nobody could do intentionally. It's so ingenious that I would have never even thought about coding something like that into the program. So that was what I was excited about. Seeing all kinds of problems, talking about them, getting them fixed, working side by side with my teammates. So what I did in my team, as what I saw as my role, is that I was a tester and I was there to break illusions. So we often, you know, believe that, you know, we designed it to work, it should work, that should be fine. And we thought that, you know, the customer is willing to pay for this. That should be fine as well. And a lot of times I was the one person who was like, what if we made a contract with the customer? You know, lean startup style. Let's take the money first and see if they actually want it. Let's sell it before we build it. And it turned out that test case showed that actually the customer never wanted it unless it was free. So it kind of gives us a bit of a ideas. So a lot of times what I do is I break illusions in those teams. And I've taken a lot of pride in this work for the last 23 years. And this pride has taken me to places where I feel that a lot of times it's taken me all of my days to just, you know, get really, really good at this. So I never thought, 3 years ago, I never thought that I would need to be, you know, focusing on programming. That wasn't the thing that I really, really wanted to be looking at. And I remember specifically being here in Latvia and talking with this gentleman here, Vladimir. He organized a session where people asked me, like, why don't I want to be a programmer? That was maybe about 7 years ago. And, you know, I gave a very strong answer that has been taped, and I watched that again, saying, you know, there's so much to do other in software development than the programming stuff. So I wasn't, you know, into that stuff so much. My team was also special in the sense that I was the first woman. I didn't see it as a problem as such. You know, I'm used to working amongst men. But I had one colleague who was nice enough to remind me every now and then that, you know, women only write comments in code. Back when this was first mentioned, I thought this was just, you know, it was nothing. It wasn't really about me even. You know, it was women. It wasn't about me. I was a tester. I wasn't even trying to write code at that point. So I kind of, you know, externalized it, put it somewhere on the side, and I only came back to it when I was thinking about reasons why I so strongly decided to identify as not a programmer. This is definitely one of those reasons. But that was a small part of the everyday life. So all of this kind of led me to the idea that I love testing. And I love testing enough to grow this like a dislike of programming. I really didn't care so much about writing code or, you know, working close with the programmers, that's fine. But writing the code myself wasn't really a thing. And only later on I realized that this is the number of languages that I have written working code in. I just had decided to forget about it for some reason, so we'll get back to those. But all of this was kind of 3 years ago, was about to change for me, in the sense that I have a daughter who is here somewhere, but not in the room apparently right now. Oh, she is there in the front row. I have a daughter, she's now 8 years old, and 3-4 years ago she was 5. And at that age, girls in particular tend to grow this idea of crowd mind. You know, if playing with car toys isn't cool, the girls won't do that because the other girls won't do that. And similarly with programming, if programming isn't cool, they won't be interested in that. And in Finland, everyone in school is supposed to nowadays learn programming. And I really didn't want to make my daughter or my son, for the fact either, I didn't want to make either one of them kind of like an outcast. I actually wanted to give them support in that. And I realized that if I told them that I have this dislike of programming, that if I told them that I believe that in the future we don't need to program, that there's, you know, so much to do around this. If I speak about that at an early age, that's going to be something that I'm passing on to my kids. So I actively wanted to, you know, tone down that belief that I had. And I started looking into how could I do that. And the way that I started doing it is, of course, working with kids, a bit bigger kids than my own. I also did similar things with my own kids in their kindergarten. So I went to kindergarten and I taught the whole group of 5-6-year-old kids, in particular the girls all together, that they are all programmers and they can do this, so that they can, you know, believe that girls do this stuff. But I also went to schools to teach basic Java to 7th, 8th, 9th graders. We usually taught them in pairs. So two people teaching, a man and a woman, just to show that this is normal for both genders, and the whole class is in the basic elementary school. That's what you would approach. So it helped me kind of, you know, work on my own attitudes, on not saying out loud that I believe that this is not the best thing to do. But the big thing really happened some years back, maybe 3 years back about, when I organized a conference in Finland. It was called Tampere Goes Agile, and I invited a keynote speaker, Woody Zuil, to talk about a strange idea. It was called mob programming. It doesn't mean mobile, it means group. Group programming. Everyone working together on one computer, and it sounded so strange. I listened to him, I was very inspired with what he shared, but I also came out of the talk thinking, that's so crazy. It would never work in my organization. And I decided that since I believe that, you know, that's a thing that I need to test, I'm out to break illusions anyway, my illusions, just as much as anyone else's. What if there is something to this? So I wanted to try it out. For over 6 months, I kept asking my team to do this with me, and they would say, no, no, it's crazy. And eventually, I found the knob that I needed to turn, which was, I am so lonely. I like you, you like me. Would you humor me just once, give me 2 hours, and we'll have an external facilitator with us as well. So that was how we then got started. So this talk really led me into trying out mob programming. Mob programming is the idea where you have the whole group working together on one computer, creating code and whatever activities you need around creating that code. And as a non-programming tester at that point, it really made no sense to me that I would, you know, waste my days in looking at other people writing code. I was telling myself I would be bored to death. I wouldn't be able to do the contribution that I normally give in my, you know, managerial or tester hat type of ways of doing things. Because we all had to be there at the same time, in the same space, on the same computer. This picture here is from an Agile conference a few years back, already, like 5 years back. The little girl there, let me show, that girl there, she's 9 years old, and she joined this group of professional programmers because she looked at mobbing as a thing that was a game, it looked fun, and it was something that she could do. And if she could do it, why couldn't I do it? So I wanted to really, really experience it. So I started trying this out a lot in the office. It took me a long time before I got it tried out in the office. So fortunately, there's always the communities. You know, you can find people around you who will try things with you on evenings, in meetups, and that's what I did. And this picture is from one of the TDD sessions of meetups, where, again, very typically, I was, again, the only girl available in the room. And that's, again, something that I'm working on to changing. Some of the newer pictures have much more women around, so daring to show up. It's, again, for adults as well. It's a group activity most often. For mobbing, the way this works is that there's somebody on the keyboard. That person is called a driver. Driver has the rule of not being allowed to think. No thinking on the keyboard. Actually, I would maybe rather say that no decisions on the keyboard, thinking and talking back and asking for clarifications, it requires thinking, so you're allowed to do that. But you're not allowed to decide what goes on, which direction you're heading. That decision comes from, especially in the practice first sessions, comes from a person called designated navigator. That's the role. Someone who speaks for the whole group of navigators and makes sure that this person here isn't listening to all of these voices, but gets the final direction right now from this one voice. Especially when you're practicing, it's good to have everyone take turns in all of these roles. And usually in the room there's a facilitator. The role of the facilitator is to make sure things are progressing and to remind people that we switch places, usually every 4 minutes, sometimes even every 2 minutes, getting the group to work as one mind instead of several individuals who are taking things into different direction. We rotate, we change places. So this is the dynamic that we use. The mechanism of not thinking is called strong style navigation. Strong style navigation is the idea that for an idea from my head to get to the computer, I must speak up about it and somebody else needs to act on it. So if you think of it in comparison to pairing of the traditional style and strong style, in the traditional side, sorry for the missing text here, apparently because of the PDF conversion, in traditional style you say, give me the keyboard. Whereas in strong style you say, please take the keyboard. I have an idea, please take the keyboard. So if you are on the keyboard in a mob and you feel strongly about having an idea, knowing which way to go, you stand up and say, somebody else, take the keyboard. That's the idea, how to work. The this mechanism of mobbing, it kind of goes with the idea that instead of having things done one after the other, where both our best and the worst get into the result that we're working on, when everyone is working in parallel, we just get the best out of everyone into the work we're doing right now. And sometimes I remember myself sitting in the mob feeling like maybe I'm not the best person to be here right now, maybe I'm not contributing, I am just learning right now. But then again, there's the moment where you feel like you know, now you're contributing something that then again saves a lot of time from others. So being there, not to correct things later, which is something that I usually do as a tester, but actually be there right when the mistakes happen, that's a big part of it. To get this to work, you need to feel safe to learn. And with the things that we talked about around being the only woman and sometimes even hearing that women only write comments in code, it wasn't obvious at first, but then realizing that actually it was easier than pairing in the sense that in a group, people tend to be on the better behavior. So that was a good thing to have. Out of all these trials, what I then did at some point when I started realizing I had now learned to do more of programming, I went to a full weekend, 3-day hackathon, all female hackathon, so I didn't have to think about the gender issues or how my teammates might feel about me only contributing the comments, which started to be a bit of a problem later. I joined this all-female hackathon and I decided that I would do the same thing there as I tried to do with my daughter. I would not tell anyone that I was a tester. I wouldn't introduce myself as a tester. I would introduce myself as a programmer and see what happens. I also introduced this group into mobbing right in the beginning of the session. There was a 4-lady group. There's only 3 of us in this picture, and the 3 of us were there for the most of the week, and the 4th, the most senior of the programmers in the group, was away sometimes, and she felt very strongly on not wasting her time as part of the mob. It turned out that these ladies, the one here, had less experience than I did. This one had a lot more experience than I did in programming. Neither one of them realized that I wasn't a programmer, because again, if I didn't talk about it, I was just contributing fully. It wasn't obvious in any way, even though I thought, you know, everybody can see that right away. And the lady who wasn't a programmer at all felt in the end of the weekend that she had contributed just as much into the code as the rest of us. So for me, it was a great experience around mobbing in the sense that we built a game that really worked well. It was built incrementally, it grew throughout the weekend, and the 4th lady, who is not in this picture when it was taken, the most senior of the programmers, she contributed the graphics instead of any of the code, because she felt that since we didn't work in the old-fashioned style, you know, giving her a part that she can work solo, she couldn't bring it into this thing at all. So we were moving so fast that it was hard for her to catch up. So all of this were like good experiences around mobbing for me. Over 2 years of about weekly mobbing, I learned that programming is kind of like writing. Getting started is actually easy, but it takes you a lifetime to get good at that. And there were a lot of other lessons than just the programming that were caught while we were mobbing. So through this like idea of osmosis, I didn't set out to learn programming, but I learned that by accident, because I wanted to get my team to gel a little better and work together in this way. But also the others learned things that they would have never known to ask from the other people in the team, including testing, which was something that I contributed a lot into the way we worked. So as the second part of this, I wanted to share with you some of the lessons or the main core things that I kind of acquired while working in this style. Not full days like Woody Zuil and his team, they work 40 hours a week in the mob format, my way of working was more like 2 hours every week, and it's still a way that I bring into my current teams to share stuff, to learn together, to get the ideas that nobody thinks we don't know or I don't know out so that I can learn them a little better. The first lesson was really foundational for me. I kind of sum it up as cognitive dissonance. Beforehand, I believed I don't want to be a programmer. And when I don't want to be a programmer, I am not a programmer. You know, I can choose what I want to be. I believed it in so strongly that I decided not to pay attention so much into the details of programming. And when I started doing that, I didn't start mobbing because I wanted to learn programming. I wanted my team to work better together. But when I started doing it, over time I learned that, you know, like every time I went to the keyboard, I knew a little bit more about it. I knew the first time I got on the keyboard, they told me VAR, how to introduce a variable, letter by letter. That was so humiliating. But the second time, 5 minutes or half an hour later with my team's eyes, second time, I already knew how to do that. And again, every repetition gave me a layer of things like this. But over time, about maybe 6 months into this, I realized that I had started writing into my blog, which is a way that I reflect a lot. I had started writing into my blog in a very different tone. Where I before said, you know, testers don't need to program, now I said, well, actually, you can learn that by accident, and it's actually kind of fun. And there's actually these tricks that you can do, and maybe, hey, there's these things that I've learned now that I'm doing things in this way. So again, for me, it was not just that I learned by osmosis, but it was more like I rewrote my past history. So my past history of dislike of programming, I just had to remember that they were the 14 languages that I had worked in. And right now, in my current team at F-Secure, there's 3 languages that I work with continuously. So it's reading code is a normal part of what I do. And writing code, especially in pairs and groups, is a big part of that as well. I also realized that even if I didn't think of it, because I thought I was an amazing tester, I had some self-esteem issues, apparently, around programming. And it's hard to not have those when you have people around you who, you know, on a side note, tell you sometimes something that isn't even about you, that women don't write anything but comments into the code. So as a non-programmer, I started to see that even in these groups, like I could contribute a lot of stuff that was very much code-oriented, very deep into the technical stuff. And there's a lot of other things than just the code that is technical. Understanding the problems and finding the right focus for the problems is actually one of the big challenges that we do in Agile teams. Then, working with various languages, what made me even more brave, I realized that while I was before thinking around code as in like it was some, you know, weird language that somebody was writing somewhere, I started realizing working in these groups of people that there's a lot more to language than just the written text. There's the whole way of how people talk to each other, how they treat each other, how they teach each other, how they share, and what kind of tools they are using, and how they share their lessons learned on that. So there's a lot of around culture and courage when you work in areas that you don't know. And this information, a lot of times, to my surprise, was transferable back to the office, to the languages that I normally worked in, instead of just, you know, being some eccentric language somewhere. I learned that communities are very different. The .NET community that I used to work with in Finland. That was my everyday life at Granlund. The .NET community around Microsoft is actually not the strongest of our communities. It feels a bit like you're not even allowed to say that you work in .NET. You know, Microsoft, bad. That's kind of the idea. Whereas the Ruby community, it's a really, really friendly towards newbies and open in that sense. I learned that while I worked with my team in these mobs, taking my turn on the keyboard, there were moments where I could correct the mistakes without egos in play. In particular, I remember this one time. I was in the room, I was feeling kind of, you know, disconnected. It was one of the early mobbing sessions that we had. I wasn't sure if I was in the right place, all of my uncertainties were still in place. And the guys were talking around me, saying like, hey, like, how should we implement this? We were doing this new technology change, a GUI component changed into a newer one. Now, how should we do this? Like, how is it supposed to be? Is it like one or many? And all of a sudden, I somehow like, you know, snapped out of my state. And I'm like, what are you talking about, one or many? Are you talking about how the user selects things? And I quickly showed them, explained them how the user does things. We did a little demo there. And they said, ooh, that would have been an expensive mistake to find later on. Because they were about to implement it based on one selection, whereas there were many selections that needed to happen at the same time. It would have been a completely different solution. And about an hour later, when we were having a retrospective, none of the guys remembered that I had corrected them. And they remembered years after when I corrected them on problems of this size and made them rework for weeks, usually, with the later feedback. So definitely something that I felt was good. A lot of times also I noticed that as a non-programmer in this kind of a group, my focus was on what's relevant to do. What do we actually need to do first? So this whole idea of agile, like doing things well, the simplest possible thing that could work. I was a person who a lot of times questioned, on like, is this the right thing to do? Is this what we really need? And a lot of times me feeling bored about, you know, going into the details somehow would give a hint that maybe there was a discussion waiting to happen around what's relevant, what do we need to build. I also learned sometimes that the painful moments when I went on the keyboard and I felt like I was slowing everyone down, those were just positive moments. I could see my team recognizing that the slowest programmer was now on the keyboard in the beginning. And they would talk to each other differently than they would without me on the keyboard. They would be much more deliberate, they would be much more thoughtful, and much more clear on what they would do. And a lot of times they didn't do the same, you know, let's just, you know, do something, let's just try random things. But they would actually listen to each other better because they didn't want me to go through all of the cycles again and again and again. And over time, you know, pointing this out to them, we learn to talk together better as a team. So the thoughtful thinking is a big part of how to do mobbing. A lot of times, I also found myself doing stealth exploration. I'm still a tester, even though I'm a programmer and a manager and whatever role I choose to take in the Agile teams. A lot of times I did stealth exploration. I would talk to my team saying things like, maybe we should talk to a business owner about this. You know, check if this is true, what we believe. I would say things like, can you open that in a different browser? And all of a sudden, they were using Chrome as the main browser, i.e. when opened, nothing worked. And we fixed it right away, early on. Things that I would often tell to my team a lot later. Or I would say, hey, we've been, you know, looking at this person's information for the last half an hour. I'm feeling kind of bored. Could we take somebody else? And again, changing the data uncovers different information. So someone needs to suggest these kind of things, and the business-oriented, managerial-oriented, or tester-oriented people might be the ones who bring out these kind of perspectives. Over time, we also started doing exploratory testing in the mob format with my team. And to my surprise, I got my developers to tell me that they never understood what was the magic that I was doing. I would touch the software and it'd break. They didn't know why, but they knew that's what's gonna happen. But in mobs, the magic, which is not really that much of a magic, started to unfold. They could see me changing things continuously. And over time, I also saw them do things like I was sitting next to one of them and he would say, oh, you'd want me to click here. And he clicked and it crashed. And he'd want me to try this. And he tried it and it didn't work. And I'm like, you know, I wasn't saying anything. I didn't say what I want you to do. You said it yourself. You have learned how I think. But I still needed to kind of hold the space to people, for people to remember how to do these kind of things. These kind of things. And the developers, they got actually really good at exploratory testing over time. And as such, I believe they became better developers who could be, build things more complete than they could before. And I had no mechanism of telling them that other than this through osmosis with mobbing. I was trying, definitely. I teach a lot of exploratory testing, even in my own companies. Another change that my team saw happening while we were mobbing is that sometimes our focus would move from technical depth to more towards technical assets. Like, for example, we would have all 10 of us in the room, and you know, somebody would say, oh, we need to have a search here. And somebody else would say that we implement searches this way. And a third person would say, actually, I implemented that last week. And we can just, you know, generalize it a bit. We can reuse whatever we have already built. And a lot of times, each individual person in that room, developers, testers, and the manager, they had pieces of information that they didn't think the others needed. And as they were there when the information was useful, they turned things into avoiding duplication and getting things into a better shape. So instead of building things badly, the group kept the others honest about finishing things, making sure you clean up after yourself, and reuse things that weren't reused before. A big thing that we also learned is that people have this tendency of fighting over ideas. You know, architects in particular, they contribute early on into the project and then they sometimes run away when the implementation starts, you know, into another project. And we found that sometimes the early ideas, we would fight about them forever, but when they were implemented, we wouldn't fight about them. So getting the best ideas into this work is having the group work on them together instead of having an individual contribute kind of the architecture and then the others do the implementation and the testing parts. And we also learned to do both. The argument that I mentioned, sometimes people really fight before selecting which way we do things. And we used a rule that is often used with mobbing, that if you have two ideas, do both. Do the one that seems less likely to be the right first, so that you get to do the other one as well. And sometimes, a lot of times, you notice that when you've done things in one way, nobody cares about the second way, but they would have, you know, spent days arguing that their way is the best. And if they actually still care, there's a reason why they care, and we are learning when we implement it in the second way. With my group, with some of the tensions that sometimes emerged, I realized that people tend to be on their better behavior in a group. They want to show how clean their code becomes. They want to show that they are nice people. Sometimes they're afraid of the manager. Might be that case as well. But usually it builds this safe environment where you can contribute, but you want to contribute whatever is the best that you can give out. We also then learned that while everyone is welcome and it's safe to work in a group, if somebody doesn't want to work in a group, you should let them opt out. In particular, one of my developers in my work, he felt about after maybe three of the first sessions that he doesn't really like being there. So he spent a whole 1.5 hour session telling everyone that this is like we're in kindergarten. I hate it, I hate it, I hate it, I hate it. 1.5 hours continuously. So we decided to let him opt out, and in about a year he said, like, it looks like you're having fun and you're doing something that where I should be, you know, involved. And he later invited himself back in. But I tried to first make him, you know, be part of it because, well, we wanted that to happen. But the best thing that I learned that we could have actually done is to let him be outside. And when the rest of the group is having a party there, it's kind of hard to say you don't want to join. So that's was a big thing for us. A lot of this stuff around mobbing is really about giving chances to learning. You don't know what you set out to learn. You don't know that when you go and work in a pair or in a group with people, you don't know what exactly they will teach you. If you knew what they have to teach you, you would ask. But a lot of times there are things we don't know we don't know. And we need to do things together to say, like, ooh, what's that tool that you're using? I've never used that before. Like, how did you do that? Or what was the keyboard shortcut? Like, you were much faster in doing this than I am. How would you do that again? So a lot of times we don't know how to ask for this, and people don't know how to train us on this. Mobbing is a great way of being intentional about learning and then learning accidentally. And another way of doing this in a really, really great way is the open spaces. You're going to have one tomorrow. And in the opening today, they talked about if you want to join. I would say, when you want to join. I hope we will be mobbing there. We will be learning from each other there. And we will be sharing stories there. Because a lot of times, we need to make space for the unscheduled learning to happen. And open spaces are an amazing thing to do that kind of things. That's where I've built a lot of my knowledge on or experiences, early experiences, on mobbing, asking people to join me. And that's what open spaces are about. I talk about learning through osmosis, and I talk about learning in particular because of the idea that learning is what makes us better. Even before I was mobbing, I've always had this work morale or work ethic where I kind of think to myself that whenever I go to work, my main thing is that I am maybe not perfect on that day, but I'm just a little better next day. Always learning. And with mobbing, the focus on learning has become even clearer in the sense that if you would be spending 1 hour every day into just pure learning, not the advancement of whatever you're supposed to be working at that moment. If that 1 hour would give you a 1% increase in your ability to deliver, it would pay, the time would pay itself back already in 1 month, 28 days actually. And if you would actually use more time on learning, you can use up to 5.5 hours of an 8-hour day to get that 1% increase so that you are again better off in the end of the year than you were in the beginning of the year, even if it takes you more effort. So learning is the mechanism that really makes us different. If you imagine comparing yourself to someone who isn't actively learning and actively taking in things and trying things out and focusing on how they could increase their output as an individual and as team. If it would take you 1 hour for 1% increase, in 28 days you're already better than they are. And if it takes you longer, that's the thing that we want to kind of like go for, that we would always find enough time to make sure that we are not just stale. Going to conferences is a great way of learning. Working together at your offices is a great way of learning, and I encourage all of that. Accidental learning is a big part of how we do things. For me, all of this experience with mobbing, working in these groups, it led me to realize that I had a bit of a uncertainty crisis that I even didn't recognize that I had had. I had ideas that I needed to push for a lot more so that I could get them implemented. And I had, you know, become as a tester, I had become really good at getting my messages across to the developers. And in the mobbing format, the great ideas would turn much faster into code and end up into the production than if I would have, you know, whatever mechanisms writing into Jira, talking to people, otherwise. So removing the distance, it's been a struggle for me, but it's definitely been worth the struggle. Learning-wise, individually, learning-wise for the team, and results-wise for the whole organization. So it's all been very positive in that sense. I've taken the learning of mobbing with my team into teaching the way that I usually test myself. Exploratory testing is the thing. This is one of the biggest mobs, and to my delight, I can see that there's a lot more ladies in this picture, not just a single one. And it's definitely the way that I like to see things, having more of an equal representation. This is over 20 people in one mob. It could be around code, it could be around test automation, it could be around manual, brain-engaged exploratory testing. But in this particular case, it's really about learning a new application, finding problems that other people have missed. So whatever you're doing, whether it's testing, programming, marketing material, project plans, whatever documentation you need to write, collect the group together. Any activity is something where you can learn when you work on it as a group. Me and Llewellyn Falco, who's here in the front, the guy with the blue hair you will probably see in other sessions today, we wrote a book to help people get started on mobbing. Because a lot of times people do these basic mistakes like not rotating. One person, the best programmer, sits on the keyboard and everybody else watches. That's a killer, don't do that. So we tried to write down the basic advice of a couple of tens of pages of how to get started. And if you go to leanpub.com and you find the mob programming guidebook there, there's this lever that you can, you know, turn all the way down to €0. You don't have to pay for it. It is there because it's a great distribution channel. We want people to try this out, and I would suggest that it might surprise you just as much as it surprised me. Whatever you want to learn, learn that in a group. Get a group together, either here or at your office. That's a great, great way of learning. Right. All right, so do we have time for a question or?
Sure. So.
One or two questions, I think.
Yes, a couple of something. So please, who would like, I will handle the...
I will repeat.
First...
So, the question is, what's the optimal number of developers in this group? There is the rule of whether you're learning or contributing, then you don't have too many people. So, kind of like a way of phrasing this that I've learned from Llewellyn is that if you think of an orchestra making music, what's the right size of an orchestra? There's all kinds of sizes, but everyone needs to be having a way of contributing or learning in that group. A typical group size would be like 6 to 8, but bigger ones work as well. You had somewhere there?
Optimizing for quality, in contrast to kind of working solo as I guess a way for optimizing for speed. Mm-hmm. And a practical question is, you mentioned that you do kind of 2 hours of mob programming a week. How do you choose the tasks? Is it random? Is it something that requires specific quality? Is it something that you could gain the most knowledge from, or what's
so
the kind of...
For my team, what's been the way of choosing the tasks is that we wanted to try out different kinds of activities. So maximizing learning has been our thing. We often started new tasks in mob format. Like we had this one particular case where we had estimated that it takes us a pair of people, it takes us 4 weeks to six, 4 to 6 weeks to complete. We mobbed with 8 people for 2.5 hours, and it was done next Monday by the pair, so it got a lot faster because of that. So when you get the right quality in early on, that would also be a good choice. So at least that was kind of like my experience, that starting together and then leaving people alone was a better way of doing things. I still hope for a project where we could do this 40 hours a week, but I don't foresee that. It's not the managers who stop me. It's usually the developers who believe that they are always faster alone. And in particular, my current developers, it's interesting sometimes to see them struggle, 3 developers struggle on a problem that they can't solve, any one of them alone, because they're all in the room, but they still feel that they would have been faster alone. So there's a lot of beliefs around this on how it needs to change.
Right. Here's one more.
All right.
You mentioned technical people participating in it. Have you tried it with managers or business people, and what did they learn?
So we have tried with business people, managers, business owners, product owners. Usually they go out saying, oh, this is so cool, I programmed, I did something real. And what I really hope they would, over longer time, which I haven't yet experienced, get is that when they are there on the right time, you know, to play the right instrument, they can save a lot of time for the team. So again, they might choose to sit on the keyboard, they might choose to just be in the room, but they have so much to contribute, and they don't need to turn into programmers.
So all right, just before we go for the coffee break, I think we need to collect feedback. So all right. For that, remember, every meeting is a workshop. So please, 3 minutes in trios, discuss what you like. All right, so 3, 2, 1, go. Awesome. Pictures taken. Thank you very much. Let's enjoy our break. We're going to have 15 minutes. Thank you, Maaret.